Do I have any more prayer cards? Where's Courtney? Children's time? Yeah, it says that. I just do what I can read here.
Turn that on.
On the first Sunday of every month, I introduce what's called the Life app. Okay? The Life app is,
there we go. Thank you. Is what we focus on throughout the month in our Sunday school classes. And it is called an app, not like an app on our phone, right? But something that we want to apply to our lives. It's an application in that way. So usually it's a word, like we've done, I think last month was perseverance, right? We've done compassion, we've done honesty. So usually it's that word that's a concept, but this month it's a little bit different, okay? We have a picture of it up here. It's a thought for us to keep kind of going around in our minds. And the question is, what is God doing in you to change the world around you? Okay? It's a pretty big question for all of us. We know that God wants us to live his way, right? He wants us to show his love to others, right, Jude Bug? Yeah. But sometimes it's kind of hard to do that, you know, just on our own. But he gave us a helper. Does anybody know the name of that helper? Anybody out there? There we go. Right, the Holy Spirit. Apostle Paul wrote that this Spirit comes and he can help us, all right? He can help us change the world around us. So, what's this?
Banana.
Yeah, it's not a trick question. What's this one? It's a plum, actually. We didn't have any apples at the house. And this? Orange. Yep. When you go to the grocery store to buy this stuff, what section of that grocery store is it? Not just the fruit. It has a special name. What? Produce. See, you should have been up here, dude. Okay? Right? It's the produce section, right? Because these things are produced, right, from a banana tree, a plum tree, an orange tree, okay? We also have vegetables out there that grow in the ground, okay? But they call it the produce section because it has been produced by all of these different plants, right? So in our memory verse for this month that we're going to be talking about for the rest of June, Paul, who you might remember was that guy who used to be mean to the followers of Jesus until he discovered who Jesus really was, and then he became just like an amazing follower of Jesus and wrote and talked to so many people about who Jesus was and is. So in his letter, okay, it's called Galatians. Can you say Galatians? Good. Galatians, okay, in 5:22-23, he says, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit produces, what's the fruit of the Spirit, Jude? Love.
Joy. Peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
That's what we're talking about, right? Yes, thank you. High five. Yeah, he's one of my chapel kids at the preschool, so we go over that a lot. Yeah, so it says the fruit of the Spirit produces love, joy, and peace. It brings patience, kindness, and goodness. It is being faithful and gentle and having self-control of oneself. And so Paul wasn't talking about this kind of fruit, right? He wasn't talking about this kind of produce. He was talking about the stuff that is produced when we have the Holy Spirit, okay? And those are the fruits of that Spirit. And so just like an apple tree produces, I know, it's still not a trick question. It produces apples, okay? Right? Yeah.
Carrots grow from the ground.
That's true, yes. And potatoes, they grow from the ground. Yeah, they produce from the ground. Okay, so just like that, the Holy Spirit helps us produce all of those other things. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Right? So we are going to be focusing on those over the next month. And that brings us back to our life app. What is God doing to change us, to change you, to change the world around you? So what is he doing in you? What kind of fruit is he producing in you that can change the world around you? And so I want to invite you guys. You're kind of automatically going to be there, but every Sunday at 10 in the summer, we do something a little bit different for our Sunday school time. We have something called Hang 10. Do you see that? Kind of looks like that, like hang loose bra, okay? Hang 10, it is multi-generational. It is all ages that are welcome to come hang out with us at 10 o'clock if you don't have a Sunday school class that you normally go to, or if you want to skip it for a week and come hang out with us. We will be going through this subject for June, and then we will have a different life app in July. But it's a fantastic way to just kind of dig in with all ages of our congregation. Yes. Hey, Judebug, will you pray with me? Oh, I love you. I love you too, baby. Thank you. Okay. Repeat after me, guys. We're going to pray. Dear God, thank you for showing us what love is by the way you love us. Thank you for giving us the Holy Spirit. Help us to show your love to others even when it's hard. We love you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Good job, dude. Bug.
I can do it.
Okay. You want to go back to mom and dad? Okay.
Any more prayer requests? Okay. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, please hear the cry of your children. For Sandra, we pray for Angela and many who suffer depression in silence. Draw near to us, O Christ, in your mercy. Let us pray for full inclusion of all of God's children in the life and ministry of the United Methodist Church. In your mercy. We pray for those dealing with natural disasters and for those in ministry to them. In your mercy. We pray for the poor, the destitute, the oppressed, and the exploited. In your mercy. We pray for those who are ill physically, mentally, and emotionally. In your mercy. We pray for those people with special needs as we name them silently in our hearts or call their names out loud. your mercy. We pray for prisoners, refugees, and all persons caught in conflict, in your mercy. We pray for the leaders of local, city, state, national, and international governments, in your mercy. We pray for the leaders of the church, for their perseverance, wisdom, patience, knowing the love of God, joy, courage, and stamina, in your mercy. Let us pray for ourselves and loved ones, beseeching God for our good health, happiness, and well-being, in your mercy. We pray that all who call you God will come to understand that you have told us who our brothers and sisters are, in your mercy. Amen. I don't know what y'all normally do for offering, so I'm going to pray, and then they're going to do their thing. Father God, please accept these gifts as we offer them. Please bless the givers and the receivers, that all these gifts may go to glorify your name. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
If I'll ever find scripture reading comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 2 through 10. We always thank God for all of you when we mention you constantly in our prayers. This is because we remember your work that comes from faith, your effort that comes from love, and your perseverance that comes from hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the presence of our God and Father. Brothers and sisters, you are loved by God, and we know that He has chosen you. We know this because our good news didn't come to you just in speech, but also with power and the Holy Spirit, and with deep conviction. You know as well as we do what kind of people we were when we were with you, which was for your sake. You became imitators of us and of the Lord when you accepted the message that came from the Holy Spirit with joy in spite of great suffering. As a result, you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The message about the Lord rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place. The news about your faithfulness to God has spread so that we don't even need to mention it. People tell us about what sort of welcome we had from you and how you turned to God from idols. As a result, you are serving the living and true God, and you are waiting for His Son from heaven. His Son is Jesus, who is the one He raised from the dead, and who is the one who will rescue us from the coming wrath. The Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's sing that chorus of Amazing Grace together. Just My Chains Are Gone. We're going to sing that twice through. My chains are gone, my chains are gone, I've been set free, my God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Played peekaboo all during the first service with this thing. So let me start over. Did you feel it? Did you feel anything? John Wesley had two passions about the Methodist Church. What was the first one? What were you just doing? Singing! Yes. In fact, he was so passionate about it, he paid his brother Charles to write hymns. Charles was smart enough to set them to tunes that the people already knew. Now, some people say they're bar songs. I don't know whether that's true or not. But they people did know them. That's a question for you, Perry. E flat walks into a bar. What does a bartender say? We don't serve minors here. What's the other thing that Wesley was passionate about? Starts with an S. Somebody said it. Scripture. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Now, one of the issues that folks that do this kind of speaking is they forget to check which one of the translations is being used. So rather than a paraphrase, I want to read you one of the verses again. This is verse 6, and this is from the New Revised Standard. "And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia." Now, this is Paul writing to the Thessalonians, and the thing that Paul is doing here is he's, first of all, he's acknowledging that they have heard the word and they are spreading the word, and in fact, they are so effective, it's already been heard in areas that he hasn't been to yet. But reports are coming back. What do we do with the word? What do we do with the word of God? Well, we study it. That's one thing. We listen for it. That's another thing. And we note those experiences where the word has meant something special to us. This apocalyptic time that the Thessalonians are living through, severe persecution, it would have been so much easier on their lives to ignore the word, to forget the word. And yet, they stay steadfast. A meaningful life requires a bedrock. What are some of your bedrocks for your life? It's a question.
Home.
Say?
Home.
Home, absolutely. Home and family. That, in fact, that's the first bedrock that most of us develop as children. It becomes extremely important to us. It's like people told me, "Bob, you don't have grandchildren." I said, "No, I don't, and I'm not going to, and all my grandchildren are going to have four legs and fur." I said, "Bob, you don't know what you're missing." And I said, "I'll bet you're right. I don't know what I'm missing." Because children are important, and they become part of our bedrock. Our spouses are important. I didn't realize how much until I lost Jean. And then I realized how much I depended upon her. What else is a bedrock?
Education.
Education is something that once you get, nobody can take it away from you. They can take a piece of paper, but education stays with you. It's one of our bedrocks. For us today, the unfailing truth of God's promises still provide us with a center that holds. Wells dry up. Famine comes, disaster ruins all that is around us. The Word of God remains ready and reliable. It is both a ballast and a buffer. The ballast of the Word keeps us on course. It keeps us secure, like the ballast in a ship. It also is a buffer. It's a buffer against things that happen to us, and it's a buffer to save us from ourselves. R. Kelso Carter was right to sing, "Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling winds of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God." Let me tell you a story. Hear it with new ears. David was king. David had one son that was a real troublemaker. Do you know who that was? Say again? Absalom. Absalom. He had two strikes against him. Number one, he was much too good looking. And his special pride was such a magnificent head of hair that once a year when he had it trimmed, the cuttings weighed 3.5 pounds. For another thing, his father, David the king, was either spoiling him rotten or reading him the riot act. Absalom murdered his brother Amnon because he was fooling around with their sister Tamar. Absalom tried to get the old war horse Joab to patch things up with King David. Joab said, nope, not having anything to do with that. So Absalom did what any teenager would do. He burned his hayfield. Later, after he patched things up on his own, he gathered himself a posse and a chauffeured chariot, and he would go stand at the gates of the city and would greet people coming to get a case settled before the king. He would tell them, boy, it's a shame I'm not a judge. I can tell just by your hometown that you are okay, and I would see that you get justice. If any of them tried to bow down in front of him, he'd grab them, give them a big hug. Absalom stole the hearts of all of Israel. They loved him. They loved his cunning. They loved his daring do. And later, when Absalom did, in fact, lead a rebellion against his daddy, King David, setting himself up as king at Hebron, a lot of them joined his army. This started a war between David and the rebels. On the eve of the crucial battle, David gathered all his chiefs of staff, told them, go easy on Absalom. If he falls into your clutches, go easy on the boy for his father's sake. Remember Joab? Joab, remembering his hayfield, kept his fingers crossed behind his back. And when Joab found Absalom, caught by his hair, suspending from an oak tree, he ran him through without blinking an eye. When they brought the news to David, it broke his heart. As simple as that. And he cried out in words that have echoed down the centuries ever since. Oh, Absalom, my son, my son. Would that I had died instead of you. Oh, Absalom, my son, my son. He meant it, of course. If he could have paid the price for the boy betrayal, he would have paid it. If he could have paid the price for his death, he would have. He could have brought the boy back to life. He would have done it. There's some things not even a king can do. As history was later to prove, it takes a God. Shalom.
So our offering at the altar rail today is going to be going to Camp Good Sam. And Byron, if you'd say a little word, a word or two or ten about Camp Good Sam.
Try not to say too many.
Say as much.
Thank you. As Mr. Eastlake has so eloquently stood in for Pastor West and done a great job, I hope I can do the same thing for the rest of the board of Camp Good Sam. As was mentioned, a bedrock of learning is so important. And Camp Good Sam, now going into its sixth year here in Wimberley, has tried to be that for the at-risk youth in Wimberley. So it is a six-week learning program based around a reading series that tries to help bring the kids from having a summer slide. And what we've proven with the summer slide is that by the time these kids that are at risk hit fifth or sixth grade, they're anywhere from 1 to 2 grade levels behind in reading from their rest of their class. So Camp Good Sam is aimed at a 6-week program for we serve just over 100 kids on average every summer to help them with their reading, but also just help give them opportunities that we all take for granted. My kids get to go to the river, they get to go to camps, they get to have fun. These kids don't have those opportunities. Some of them are at home by themselves throughout the week when their parents are working and they don't even have food. So Camp Good Sam also is just a stable environment for 6 weeks. We provide breakfast, we provide lunch and a snack, along with that in learning environment to help with the success of their future. We've seen great results. The school district is a great partner, allows us to use a school, also allows to run their buses to bring the kids to and from camp every day. And we've seen great improvement of the rest of the teachers and the praises of how they haven't had to help bring these kids back up in the midst of teaching the rest of the other classes. So anything you can give would be great. If you like to volunteer and want to show and just be the hands and feet of God in the community, and show them examples of how other people care and give them a learning experience of that as well, we'd love to have you out and participate in the next 6 weeks of camp that starts tomorrow morning. So, and on July 6th, Big Scoop is our fundraising arm of Camp Good Sam, and I know we have quite a few folks in the church that are part of Big Scoop. July 6th at 1 p.m. at the community center, come out and eat a lot of ice cream and give some more money. Thank you.
Thank you, Byron. If you would turn to page 12 in your hymn book as we begin to celebrate Holy Communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We've not done your will. We have broken your law. We've rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now on the top of page 13 for the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you and broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He offered it to his disciples, and he said, "Take this, drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you remember me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And so, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just as there is one loaf, we too are one, for we are one body offered to the world through Jesus Christ. The cup that we bless is a sharing in the blood of Christ. These gifts of God are really the vitamins of eternal life. They are offered to anyone who wants to have a closer relationship with Jesus. Anyone is welcome to this table. Anyone and everyone, for this is the table of Christ. We have gluten-free elements at the center station. We'll have two serving stations on either side. If you are assisting, will you please come forward?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. You see on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home. earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies, mercies for you and for me?
Oh God, we give you great thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Enable us to use the strength of this meal that we might go out and proclaim your word and show your love to a world that needs it. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Let's stand together and sing our final song. Every secret and every shame and every fear and every pain on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine. We are called to spread the news, to tell the world the simple truth. Jesus came to save us, freedom in his name. So let his love break through. And we are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. And we are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine. Let the light shine. Light shine, we're singing. We are the light. We are the light. We are the light. So let your light shine brighter. We are the light. We are the light. We are the light. Jesus, you are the light. You are the light. You are the light. And we will lift you high and shine, shine, shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine.
No.
What?
Yeah, you did. You said it out loud.
You said that.
You did.
We're kidding.
We need.